Appreciate the praise team. I appreciate the music this morning. It's good to sing unto the Lord, isn't it? I was going to start this about 3-4 months ago, and I knew we needed the beginning half of Ephesians in order to understand the ending part of Ephesians. And talking about a godly marriage. I want you to get the concept of that verse, though, as we start. And brought her unto the man. I want us to think about how God probably has a better view of life than we do. You think? So many times we think, regardless of what God says, we really got a better plan. I do. How many else, huh? And then you usually go, oh, that wasn't, you know, God's pretty smart. He, wouldn't it be cool to know things before they happen so you can interject into them? I mean, I'm not talking about the friends that you got and you go, I told you so. I'm talking about truly in your own life, knowing the consequence, knowing... I know most of you are like, just a lotto number, I just need one. No, knowing what's in the future. And it can change. And here's where faith really should help us greatly, is God does know the future. God knows what's going on. And I want to say this as we start. I know the divorce rate is 50%, and some folks have gone through divorce that are here. But please hear my heart on this. I don't want you to think and on everything. Get this down. For instance, if I was preaching, no one would have any problem this morning if I preach, thou shall not kill, and you were a murderer, right? And we live in a fallen world, so divorce happens. We're sinful people trying to do godly things. And so don't let your situation ever hinder you from understanding the truth of God's situation. You following me? Because, I mean, there's things I've done, but I don't wipe out those portions of Scripture, right? I still want my kids, I still want the next generation to see the blessings of God and His intent. And so never take it personal and don't sit there feeling bad, guilty. Give it to God and say, okay, God, what do we do, right? Because that's what we got to do with every sin in our life, correct? And we're confronted. We got, okay, God, yes. I know you said don't do A, B, C, or D, and I've done them all. And so you then got to give it to God in it. So divorce happens because we live in a fallen world. And please don't throw out God's plan because of your situation. So give it to God. And that's my prayer. That's my understanding. And this is a lot of times because people don't follow God's plan or things that they did didn't work. Sometimes for preachers it makes it hard to preach on. And the thing is, truth is truth regardless of where we are. So let's start with a word of prayer this morning. Father, thank you for everyone here. Regardless of where we are in our walk, regardless of what is happening in our lives, or rather what we chose not to listen, and Father, Lord, maybe it's nothing of us, but Father, Lord, we're sinners. So we just give you our situation right now. Father, we give you our relationship right now. And Father, Lord, I pray that you'll help us to glean what you like and what you desire, what your word says and what your plans are for us. And Father, I just pray that you'll help us to put in place today what will help us to live closer to you tomorrow. And so, Father, just work in our hearts, open them, and our minds, open them. Father, Lord, allow your Spirit right now to help us understand the truths of your word. And Father, help us to understand by following you, we are truly blessed. And so we thank you for what you're going to do in our lives this morning. In Jesus' name, amen. Let me just say this. Marriage bookends the Bible. And what I mean by that, did I sing what? The B-I-B-L-E. See, this is why life goes wrong, because I've been reading out of the I don't even know how to say that word. If you read out of the Bible, you won't be able to follow the Bible. It's the only way I know y'all are paying attention. But the beginning of the Bible quickly institutes marriage. And we get to talk about the covenant. But I want you to see in Revelation 19, it ends with the marriage of the Lamb. And I want you to get a hold of this, because all through Scripture, when we talk about the human marriage, it's also a reflection of our eternal marriage. So I just get this thought. When you get saved, you become the bride of Christ. Now, I don't know about you. As a man, I have a hard time with the whole concept. But spiritually, we become the bride of Christ. And get this, we're married into the family of God. We're called the sons of God. But somehow, spiritually, the church becomes the bride of Christ. And there's a lot of scripture that points to us not living an adulterous life before God. Right? And anytime we sin, we're messing with the marriage. And causes trouble. So as we think of the earthly marriage, understand there's a picture, there's a type of what we should be in our heavenly marriage with Christ. And one day there's going to be a feast and a uniting beyond our imagination. Marriage is a good thing. When God created all the things in the earth, when he got done with creating light and got done creating all the creatures, at the end of everything, he made a statement. What was that statement? It is good. Right? He said, it's good. Man, this is great. This is wonderful. And he sees man alone. And he says, it is not good that man should be alone. I will make him a helper comparable to him. Now, I want you to just think about that for a minute. Because God could have said, hey, suck it up, Adam. Right? Just deal with it. Some of y'all right now going, oh, man, that'd be a bunch of guy club, man. That'd be awesome. Garden of Eden would have been, just create some more men. We just hang out. Anyway, just joking, because that's not the way it would have been. But here's the thing. I just think for a minute how awesome God is towards our situation and our feelings. God cares about your relationship. God cares about what you're going through. Because God could have said, deal with it. But he said it's not good. He saw what was going on in his life and said, I will make him a helpmeet. I will give him somebody that will be able to help him honor and glorify me. Now, this morning, whatever you're going through, sometimes we feel like God doesn't care. Maybe your marriage is bad. Maybe your relationships are flawed. Maybe you don't feel like you have any friends. Maybe whatever's going on, I want you to understand right now, this morning, that God cares. And he's saying it's not good. And he desires to bring people into your life to help you. Now, what do I mean by that? Here's the thing. Stop looking. A country song came to my head. Stop looking. I can't get rid of it. Stop looking in all the wrong places. All right? It's so many times we want to bring somebody in and we're like, well, I'm going to try this club or that club. Listen, one of the greatest institutions God formed in the New Testament was the church. And this is the place where we should fellowship and get together and spend time with each other. It takes effort to spend time together because we're all busy, but we just go, no. This is going to be more important, and not just Sunday morning, but ongoing. So God then says in Genesis chapter 2, and we're getting to Ephesians, by the way. This is trying to get us there. He says this, and the rib which the Lord God had taken from man, made he a woman, brought her unto the man. And Adam said, this is now bone of my bone and flesh of my flesh. She shall be called woman because she was taken out of man. Therefore shall a man leave his father and mother, shall cleave unto his wife, and they shall be one flesh. This is God's intent. This is some of the references we get to what a covenant is. See, you're going to leave and cleave and onto your wife, your spouse, and you're going to become one. And the intent is that you're entering a covenant that never should be broken. That's the intent, that it will be forever. Now, listen, if you only seek a spouse out of happiness, right? I mean, Adam dated everyone that was there before he got to Eve, just so you know. And he married Eve. How did he get married? God was the one over it. God was the one who brought her. God was the one who performed the service. And he intended for the two to become one. The word to become one means to occupy the same space. And this is what's important in marriage. Marriage never starts out where we occupy the same space, right? Because God brings someone into our lives that aren't like us, but someone who could help us. See, if you're looking for someone who could just bring happiness, you're going to end up marrying the wrong person. Because they're not going to do what God intended. Let me just say, we'll get to it later. I don't know. I'm 99% sure I'm not finishing this morning. All right? So we'll try to find a good landing point, and then we'll do B next week. But it's to occupy that same space. And God wants that. God says it's good. How many here have been married, oh, say over 20 years maybe? And you remember those first few years where you had no arguments, right? And there's no fighting. No problems. Joyce and I still have that. What? Let me read this quote. Stanley, whatever his name is, says there's an assumption out there in the culture there, someone just right for us to marry. And if we look closely enough, we will find that right person. It's this consumer mindset. And let me interject in here. One of the criteria that we should be looking for a spouse is someone who loves the Lord. Your heart should be so given to God that it takes someone whose heart is so given to God that's the only way y'all are going to get together. And there's this object of God is the one in control. And the second we stop out of that, listen, we start to say, God, I can find someone myself. And we look for qualities that are all earthly and temporal instead of looking for something that is eternal and God glorifying. He goes on, this overlooks a crucial fact about marriage. It has failed to appreciate the fact that when you get married, you always marry the wrong person. I had to stop when I was reading some of these commentaries and things. Always marry the wrong person. Why? Because, see, when you're dating and you're in the new relationship, there is no battling. Right? And God then starts to put you together, and the rough edges have to come off. Now, I just will say, the guy usually turns into a cylinder quicker for some reason. And so God works the change. Two people occupying the same place is going to have trouble. Amen? It's just the way it is. And so somehow in marriage, the love, but if you're not entering also into a covenant where there's a commitment to when we start seeing the rough edges, there's a problem. This is why we live in a culture where people who now are getting married older. I'm going to give you theory one why people can get married older is because they're doing everything they're supposed to be waiting to get married to do before they get married. And so, we can wait. Of course you can wait. If you were living the way God intended, you'd be like, we get married tomorrow at 8 o'clock. Right? And so, and then people are living together. This is an old statistic. I haven't looked it up for new. But people who live together, the divorce rate is 75%. Those who live together before they get married. 75. Why? Because, listen, when you enter a covenant, when you enter a marriage, when you say, I do, you come together and you're committed. When you're living together, in the back of your minds, they can leave at any time. Right? And so what do? You live a little more not yourself. And then when you get married, after you live together, and you start to be yourself, usually one person is going, good grief, I didn't see this person for 3 years. Who is this? Right? And the whole thing falls apart. Because the whole intent of entering into a covenant, even if it's with someone who rubs you kind of wrong, is that we're committed together for God's honor and for God's glory, and he gets to work. We never know who we marry, right? I thought I knew Joyce before we got married, but I know her much better now, right? You think you do, but until you start to occupy the same space, even if we first marry the right person, just give it a while, and he or she will change. For marriage, being an enormous thing that it is, means we are not the same person after we've entered it. The two become one. We occupy the same space. And it should be the person God brings. And the goal of a marriage covenant is that what God has joined together, let not man separate. Listen, here's the thing we got to understand. Is if you're not in it for the end, it's never going to make it. I always said Joyce and I agreed before we got married we'd never talk about divorce. Death, maybe. But if you, you know, it's like, hey, you know, I put it on a weird level. You know, if you got an older car, you tolerate things for a while. And if you don't fix the little things because you're thinking you're going to get a new car, eventually you're just like, I'm done. Marriage, listen, you've got to be working on all the little things and all the things that are going on in order for it to work. Or somewhere, you're just going to see something shiny and new out there and go, oh, this got to be better. This person understands me. No, they don't. They don't even know you. The reason you're having some conflicts at home is that person's starting to know you. And you got to work through it. Look at this here. For the first time in history, we're going to shift a little gear. For the first time in history, Western civilization is confronted with the need to define the meaning of the term marriage and family. Isn't that sad? For centuries, family and marriage was easy. Until now, we considered a normal family made up of a father, a mother, and a number of children. Has in recent years begun to view as one or more, or one among several options. I just want you to know it is not a cultural war, but a spiritual war. Because remember where we started. God instituted, God said this is the way marriage should be. It's a picture of our union, even with Christ, up to the end. And if there's one thing Satan hates, is anything biblical. I was listening to yesterday as I was driving to Timothy Keller. He's teaching on marriage, and he's giving some points, and he's going through some neat things, and he's taking question and answer. All the questions come in, and he's about to end, and someone else has the mic, and he almost ended, but he saw somebody with the mic, and he said, okay, I'll take that question. And the person said this, is your book, he has a book on marriage, and he says, is your book applicable to gay marriage as well? And it was just interesting because that's what, you know, hey, marriage is marriage, no matter what it is. That's what the culture wants us to believe. And I appreciate his answer because his answer was simply, hey, I wrote my book from a Christian perspective. And the Christian perspective and the Bible perspective has always been one man, one woman. That's it. You can take Scripture and apply it to whatever you want, but you lose the truth of it when you try to make it fit into something that is unbiblical. And so as we start this morning, I wanted to give you a concept of where we are and what's going on. And pray for our culture, because it's just getting weirder and weirder. And I truly believe it's because us as Christians, we're not on our knees enough. We've accepted our sins, and so no longer can we be a godly voice to a lost world, right? Because we want to identify with them, we want to be like them, we're going to act like them. And so no longer do we have a voice to speak against. And so our whole culture, and I believe because the church is failing to be godly, God's blessing is pouring back from the United States. And he's letting us be who we are. And for Christians, that's going to be destructive. What I just said at the beginning of the message and indicated towards homosexual marriage, in a few years, will be hate speech, and I could have somebody come in and shut us down. It'll be hate speech. It already is deemed hate speech out there. And this is why Christianity, listen, we got to stop trying to be like the world and start to stand strong again on the word. We want to reach them, But we never want to sacrifice our marriage with the Lord in order to reach the lost. And so really, really keep it in prayer. Keep it in an understanding of what's God doing. So what does this godly marriage look like? Not like a 23-minute introduction. We looked at this verse, Ephesians 5, verse 21. It says, submit yourselves one to another. We talked about submitting to one another. We talked about the fear of God. Okay? And in those contexts of I'm going to reverence God, then it is easier, right, when our life is aligned with God, for a wife to submit herself to her own husband and get the last phrase there, right? As unto what? The Lord. It's a spiritual thing. Now, submitting doesn't mean slavery. Please don't even put that in the same context. It is to reverence your spouse. It is to hold up. And most men are looking for the reverence and respect, and most women are looking for that endless love that we'll talk about soon. And so in a marriage, listen, God instituted the marriage where there is this development. God doesn't just say, go have a marriage. God says, look, I'm going to give you a marriage, and I'm going to tell you that the husband is the head of the wife. In the Greek, it says, but the wife is the neck and turns the head ever. No, I'm just, it's not there. It is the head. Look, that is not something where you should go on the head. Listen, that's a responsibility from God. What's going on with your children? What's going on in the spiritual life in your home? It's you. You're the one, Dad, are going to be held accountable for the living God about your family. Headship is not something that you just go, I'm the boss, right? When you're the boss, even when offering plates are going, people are going, where's the offering plates? How are we going to take an offering? I don't know. I was getting hats out of my office. We'll just pass the hat. But here's the thing. No matter, right? There's these things that are there. Christ is the head of the church. And he's the Savior of the body. So he puts it in an implication how Christ should be the head of the church. The man should be the head of his relationship. And listen, man, we're living sad times because it is the women doing most of the spiritual leading in the home. And we're missing it. I'm not saying that I did a great job. I didn't. But that God, though, is going to hold me accountable. And listen, church, let me just say this as we're here in this scripture, and we know we're not finishing this message this morning, but that Christ is the head of the church. Think about that. How many times do we truly go, God, how do you want to work today? Right? He should be ahead of what we're doing, the local body, what's going on. Christ is the one leading, Savior of the body. It's as Christ. Now, I'm going to do a couple more thoughts and I'm going to bring it down. Because here's the thing. In marriage, one of the most important things is for two to walk together with the same goal, same objective. 2 Corinthians 6 says this, Be ye not unequally yoked together with unbelievers. The hardest marriages, listen, to ever function is when one is lost and one is saved. Now I'm going to say something. Listen, young people, I truly believe this. Every date is a potential mate. Why? Because somewhere your heart may be given to that person. And there's a lot of people here, and listen, just hear my heart. No matter how you did it, I just want you to know the truth of how God intended it to be. You should not date a lost person as an evangelist. You can befriend them, but you should not open your heart to a relationship unless they love the Lord. Now listen, I don't want to hear, I understand. Yours turned out. But I can give you 1,000 more that hasn't turned out. So listen, please hear my heart. Don't ever make your situation turning out okay gospel. That's the grace of God. Because in a marriage, you need the two to be pursuing after the love and instruction of God. For what fellowship? See, it's fine now. I had a friend who married someone who wasn't a Christian, and he called me. He asked me before he got married, and we walked through it. I said, the first trouble is going to come is when the kid is born. Because their philosophy of who God is and what they should do is this. And your philosophy of what you should do and raise the kid is this. And so now there's this clash, and you can't get the kids to follow God because God is not the singular thing in the family. Now, you say, what do we do if we're here? You surrender it to God. And pray that both y'all could start to love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind, so that the kids don't see, on dad believes this, mom believes this, and they're just like, well, it doesn't seem like any of this is real important. So God has to be that center focus of what is going on. And my heart, listen, because I've done this long enough that I know there's people here going, well, you're saying I married the wrong person. And I'm saying biblically you did. But it's your spouse now. So love them. Encourage them in the things of the Lord. You say, well, what do I do? How do I put it back? How do I change it? You love them. Give them to the Lord. And you live as a godly example until God can bring him or her around to serve the Lord. You say, how do I help my kids? I'd be honest with them. Everyone loves a cycle breaker if he's an alcoholic or a druggie. Oh, they broke that cycle. I'm thankful. This morning my cycle was broken. And it's cool that my kids are in church today. And it's cool and exciting for me to know my kids and my grandkids are going to be in church today. That wasn't a cycle I was broken in. We'll celebrate that. But listen. Whatever you did that was unbiblical, one of the things your kids need to hear is, I should have, boom. Because, listen, whatever hurt, whatever pain you're feeling, I guarantee you don't want your kids to feel it. Whatever struggles or things are going on, I guarantee you don't want your children to do it. And listen, the only way to stop something is to repent of it, surrender it to God. I'm telling you, you'll have a happier marriage instead of going, well, it just worked out for me. Because God then gets to work. And I'm not saying you don't have a loving marriage. I'm not saying you don't have a marriage that is going great. I'm just saying, is God then the center of it? Because it's hard. How can two walk together unless they agree? And so that's the introduction. That's about all I'm going to have time for. And I want you to pray about this one thing. What is my life going to be like? And I want to jump all the way back to the beginning, where God saw Adam, and he looked at him and said, "This is not good." And so wherever you are, and I hope I didn't disturb you, unless I disturbed you to repent. I hope I didn't disturb you to just make you feel bad. I hope I did it so maybe God can change something. But don't leave thinking it was a mean message to start. Please come for the conclusion next week. But also, please hear this. Hear this, that God right now cares for you. I'm thankful for the grace of God. God can take your marriage and do something spectacular. But have you ever repented and said, "God, I give it to you"? God can repair relationships. But we got to come clean with God and say, "God, I messed up. No one ever gets a divorce in an isolation place where only one spouse is at fault. Usually, there's already a tearing away from the things of God and the walk with God and the understanding of God. And so, I just want you to hear God cares for you. And he wants to do something awesome in your marriage. He wants to do something awesome in your family. Young person who's sitting here saying, "I don't even know why I'm here. This message definitely doesn't pertain to me." I just want you to know, stop looking for a man and start praying for God to bring you one. And men, stop just looking for women and start praying for God to bring you one. Because he cares. And he's going to know what you need. And so, bow your heads right there where you are, your eyes closed, attitude of prayer. Just where we're sitting. We're not standing. We're just going to sit. I just want you to know, as pastor, I feel your heaviness. I really think that's why God kept pushing me away. I think part of it was just me. Because being here a while, I know situations. And I know your heart is to do for the Lord. I really do. And I know we live in a sinful world, and I will never tell you divorce is always wrong. It should never be the goal. But we can't control everything in every situation. But I will tell you this. God cares and loves you. Desires to work in your relationship and your marriage. And I just plead with you to surrender it to God this morning. And say, "God, I want you to work in it. I want you to move in it. God, save my spouse. God, help my children to want to pursue the godly half of this marriage. God, help them to see it was important. And I didn't take it as important as I should about my marriage to you. And I didn't do exactly right." Or maybe this morning you believe you got a good marriage. I beg with you right now to pray, "God, put a hedge about my marriage. Satan hates it. Wants to destroy it." Father, right now, just move in our hearts. Encourage us to have biblically founded marriages that are a covenant we enter with you, an eternal promise to follow, to obey. I'm thankful we can understand that this morning. And I pray that you just work and move and guide in our hearts. I ask you to stand to your feet. If God has moved in any way, the altars are open. I just pray that you'll come and surrender to him and allow him to do a work in your life, in your marriage, in your home, and your kids.
If you'd like to find out more information or keep up to date on what's happening here at Memorial Baptist Church, you can visit us at our website, www.mbcnewhaven.com, where you can find our weekly bulletin, our church calendar, and also previous sermons. You can also find us on Facebook, YouTube, and also our Church Link app. All that information is on our website, so come on by, check it out, and thank you for joining us.